Hey everybody, I'm back on the road again, as you can see. This time I'm in Virginia, playing some soccer at a weekend tournament and watching a little NASCAR down in Richmond. One thing I've been struck by in Virginia, which I gather is a state that prides itself on low taxes, is there's no recycling bins anywhere to be found at this tournament. Perhaps I'm wrong, but I haven't found them yet. So at any rate, the second unit is on the Earth's climate system. It's going to lead you to understand why global warming will cause climate change and will lead you to understand what exactly that means. So today what we want to do is we really want to look at how the climate system works, the basic idea behind the working of the climate system. So let's get started. Weather and climate. You have heard both of these words, but what do they mean and what is their difference? Well, as the old expression says, climate is what we expect and weather is what we get. Weather are the conditions in the atmosphere at a given place and a given time. Today, it is hazy, hot, and humid here in Richmond, Virginia. 90 degrees, probably 80% humidity, clear skies, thin cloud cover at best, no precipitation, light wind. That's the weather today. So the temperature, the precipitation, the cloudiness, the relative humidity, etc., give you the weather. In contrast, the climate is the average weather conditions that occur in a place over a period of years. And typically that time frame is about 30 years. So we want to know what was the average weather like at this time of year over a period of 30 years. And the two most important factors tend to be temperature and precipitation. So let's look at this a little further. Now, regional climate, what actually happens in a given region, is determined by many factors. One is latitude. Latitude is the angle between the plane of the equator and where you are on Earth. And if you need to understand that a little better, let's ask about that in class. Latitude is important because it determines the amount of sunlight received by the Earth at any given time of the year. And we're going to talk more about that. Second, proximity to oceans. As you could imagine, that would be important. And surprisingly, also to ocean currents, which we're going to discuss a little bit in this unit. And terrain and altitude. So terrain, for example, position relative to mountains, what's the surrounding landmass like near you, and altitude, how high you actually are up above sea level. And then the effect of seasonality, of course, and we're going to have to talk about seasonality. Regional climate is usually characterized by five variables: temperature, precipitation, humidity, atmospheric pressure, and wind, average wind speed. And I bet you could have guessed them all if you tried. So let's look at some of these. We're going to go back and review a few of these. Well, here's the first thing. This was a surprise to me when I first thought about it. What happens to the sun's light energy when it enters the atmosphere? Well, as you can see, if you look up here, only 69% of it gets absorbed and 31% of it gets reflected before it even gets to the surface of the Earth. Well, actually, that's not true. 22% of it gets reflected before it reaches the surface of the Earth, and then 9% is reflected by the ground. So 9 plus 19 is 28, and 3 is 31, the total reflection. Now, only about 49% is absorbed by the ground, another 3 is absorbed by clouds, and then 17% of it is absorbed by molecules in the air and dust in the air. So that makes a grand total of 69% of total absorption. So let's think about that. Now, the sun's energy helps determine the mean annual temperature in an area. If we were to think about Washington, D.C. over the course of the year, what is the average annual temperature? So take the temperature every hour of every day and then average those 24 hours over 365 days of the year. You will have the mean annual temperature for D.C. And of course, then we do it over 30 years to make it a climatic variable. The mean annual temperature is the average temperature at a location over the course of a year. As you might imagine, it varies with latitude, but how? Mean annual temperature is highest at the equator and lowest at the poles. Duh, that makes sense, I'm sure to you. The next two slides show the average temperature on the land masses of the Earth. You know I love showing maps, and here they come. Look at this. This is a climatic mean, 1951 to 1980. They're the 30 years we've been talking about. And look at where it's hottest. Now, you'll have to remember, where's the equator? Well, the equator is right in the middle of this thing, right, where it bulges out the most, right? It goes through this part of Africa, goes through the Amazon and northern South America, and it goes through the Indonesian and Malaysian archipelago and just north of Australia, right? That's the equator right there. And you can see, indeed, the warm parts are in the middle and the cold parts are here out at the poles. And notice that Antarctica, much colder than even the northern extremes. And these are land temperatures, because sea temperatures are always moderated compared to land temperatures. And we'll talk about that in a little bit. So this is a GIF of mean annual temperature, and you'll see it switches over the course of the year. I'm just going to let you watch it for a while. Did you notice that the band of warmth moves north and south over the course of the year? And as you would expect, in the northern summer, it's warmer. The average temperature is warmer. And during the northern winter, the average temperature in the north is cooler. Okay, let's move on. Here is a map that shows the mean annual temperature as a function of moving away from the equator. On your left is the northern hemisphere, and on your right is the southern hemisphere. You might want to stop the video in a second and see what you notice that's different about the two sides of the graph here. I'll let you stop it. Okay, hopefully you noticed that the slope on the right-hand side, the southern hemisphere side, is smaller than the absolute value of the slope on the left-hand or the northern hemisphere side of this graph. And what that means is that as you go north from the equator, the average temperature drops faster than as you go south from the equator, right? The southern hemisphere is warmer than the northern hemisphere. So why would that be? You might want to stop the video and take a guess. Okay, you're back now. Here's why. Think about the position of land masses. The maps at right and below show how much more land there is in the northern hemisphere than in the southern. Here we have a top view, if you consider north top, and a bottom view of the hemispheres, much more land in the top view, in the northern hemisphere view. And here we have a regular flat map, and you can see that the northern hemisphere has a lot more land than the southern hemisphere. And water, as you may remember from chemistry, has a huge heat capacity and huge amount of thermal inertia as a result. This means it resists temperature change. So the southern hemisphere resists temperature change compared to the northern hemisphere, and therefore the land doesn't quite contribute to as much heating during the southern summer, nor does it contribute as much to the cooling during the southern winter, and you get that shallower slope as a function of latitude. Why does temperature change with latitude? Well, here's a picture of me that I drew thinking about that question a few years ago. I scratched my head and I just had trouble figuring it out, but I persisted. And this might be a time when you would like to shut off the video and write down your hypothesis. And I'll give you a clue. There are three reasons for it. See what you can do with them. Okay, you're back with your three reasons. Did you get these reasons? Okay, reason one. Due to the Earth's spherical shape and tilt, solar energy does not hit the Earth uniformly. In the equatorial regions, light comes directly down, and a certain cross area of light, when it enters the atmosphere, illuminates a certain cross area of land. If you go to a 45-degree angle, the sun makes a 45-degree angle with the Earth, then you go up to the same cross section of light coming in, intercepts 1.4 units of surface area, and therefore the light is less dense. And if you go to a 30-degree angle, if the sun makes a 30-degree angle, which is what it's close to in our Washington, D.C. winter, then the surface area that the light falls over is 2 units of surface area. So in other words, it's twice as diffuse. The light density is twice as diffuse as in the tropics where it's overhead. And therefore, you have less light hitting the surface and therefore less temperature gain. That's reason number one. Reason number two, the smaller the angle at which the light hits the Earth, the more it reflects. And this is somebody's law in physics. If you took ninth grade physics already, I think you'll remember, I think this is called Snell's law. And if you remembered that, go tell Mrs. Pratt that you remembered that, and she will give you a big high five. I can guarantee it. So that's a law. The smaller the angle of incidence, the more reflectance. So you can see here, there's going to be more reflectance than here, where there'll be more absorbance. And therefore, there'll be higher temperature gain here than here. And finally, the third reason, Light at higher latitudes travels through more atmosphere, and therefore it has more of a chance to reflect. Because if you see the atmosphere as a uniform band around the Earth, then you'll see at an angle it has to travel through a greater distance of atmosphere, and therefore there's more of a chance of absorption up high, which causes less thermal gain, or of reflection before it even hits the ground. Okay, so there are the three reasons. So to review, here's a self-test. Let's see how you do. The sun's rays arrive at the Earth essentially parallel to each other as shown in this diagram. Now, the sun is not that close to the Earth, but that's just for illustrative purposes. At which location does the sun travel through the most atmosphere? Is it at the equator, or is it at the poles, or somewhere in between? If you chose at the poles that it travels through more atmosphere, then pat yourself on the back. You win a great big Cupid doll. It's an imaginary virtual Cupid doll, but still you should feel proud of yourself. Second test question. At which location is light most likely to be reflected? At the equator, at the poles, or somewhere in between? I'll give you a second to answer this. If you answered that it's reflected more at the poles, give yourself a great big pat on the back, because that's correct. And now question three. Hopefully you're not seeing the answer pattern here. At which location is the light spread over the largest surface area? Is it A, at the equator, B, at the poles, or C, somewhere in between? Give yourself a second to think about it. Turn off the video if you need to. You're back. If you said that it's spread over a larger area at the poles, give yourself a gigantic, humongous pat on the back. And if you got all three, just jump up and down, run around the room, and high-five everything you can find. Let's go a little bit deeper into how the temperature of the Earth is determined. First thing we have to say, the Earth is at a perfect temperature for life. And why is that? It's mostly because the water on Earth is mostly in a liquid state. And we want to know, so why is it at that temperature? Here's the two processes as a physicist you need to know about. Right? The Earth is warmed by the sun. But the Earth is cooled by emission of its own radiation, its own electromagnetic radiation, back into space. And what I'm saying there is, as the Earth heats up, it sends energy back into space in the form of infrared radiation. And it turns out that all things that have a temperature re-emit light. If you have a really high temperature, then you emit visible light. But if you're at the temperature we are here at Earth, then you emit infrared radiation. And infrared radiation is what an infrared camera can pick up. And we tend to call it heat or body heat. But it is a form of light. It's part of the electromagnetic spectrum. So yes, when somebody who's very new age says we all emit energy, man, they're right. No matter how hippy-dippy that sounds, they're absolutely correct. So that's kind of cool. So the average temperature of the Earth is an equilibrium between the absorption of sunlight and then the re-emission of infrared light back into space. Physicists can make that calculation easily. They can look at the energy flux coming in and the rate at which energy would go back out. They can set up a little model. And the first guy to do this was Joseph Fourier. And those of you who are in BC calculus will learn about Fourier series. He was a mathematician and physicist from the early 1800s. And he figured out that average surface temperature of the Earth should be minus 18 degrees centigrade. That's way below the freezing point of water, which is 0 degrees centigrade, in case you forgot. Hopefully you haven't. If you haven't, high-five something else in the room. Good. Okay. However, the average surface temperature is about 15 degrees centigrade. So it's 33 degrees centigrade warmer, which is about, 55 degrees F warmer, something like that. You can do it. 33 times 1.8. You figure that out. Let me know what it is in class. So why is there a difference of 33 degrees centigrade? Why is the Earth so warm? Well, here's our basic climate model. It's the atmosphere. And not just any atmosphere, but the particular atmosphere that we find here on Earth. And so if you want to know an ecosystem service that the atmosphere performs, it's providing a climate for the Earth as a whole that we can survive in. The infrared radiation emitted by the Earth is absorbed by several atmospheric gases, and these are the so-called famous greenhouse gases. And you've heard about these a lot. You've grown up hearing about the specter of greenhouse gases your entire life. And what these gases do is they re-emit energy that they absorb in all directions so that much of it then returns to Earth. And the Earth will absorb it and then re-emit it, but then the greenhouse gases are there to catch about 50% of it again and send it back to Earth. Thus, the rate of energy lost into space now is reduced in comparison to what it would be if there was no atmosphere. And as a result, the Earth's temperature rises. Now, that's an ecosystem service. As the temperature increases, the rate of radiation of IR light into space increases until you get a new equilibrium between the greenhouse gases absorbing and sending energy back and the higher rate at which it is radiated back towards space by the warmer ground. Here we have it in pictures. Okay, so I have some pictures. I think I got this off a NASA website or something like that. The natural greenhouse effect in three steps. Step one, the sun's visible wavelengths of radiation pass easily through the atmosphere. They're not absorbed and reach the Earth. Approximately 51% of this sunlight is absorbed at the Earth's surface by land, water, and vegetation. Step two, some of the energy is emitted from the Earth's surface back into the space in the form of infrared radiation, and that's represented by these new arrows that showed up. And then much of the infrared radiation does not reach space, however, because it is absorbed by the greenhouse gases and is then re-emitted as infrared radiation back towards the Earth's surface and also towards space. And this process is known as the greenhouse effect. Here's another picture of the greenhouse effect, just so you can take a look at that on your own time at some point. So, the phenomenon is called the greenhouse effect because it is similar to what happens in a greenhouse, but it's not exactly the same. And that's what the Nathan Hale operator right here is telling you to look in the notes of this presentation. And here's what it says there. The atmosphere doesn't have a roof. The Earth's greenhouse effect is not quite as strong as a greenhouse's greenhouse effect in some ways because of the lack of a roof. There are other complications as well, but they're beyond the scope of this course. This model was first understood in the 1800s, and since then the model has been improved and been made much more complex as new variables are added. And it turns out it's a really good model, and much of the development of this highly corroborated model, and that's what I mean, it's a really good model, there's a lot of data to support it, occurred long before anybody realized that anthropocentric global warming was a thing. And that means the model was developed free of politics that now surround this model. I think that's a really important point. Some people would have you believe that this was a conspiracy, the development of this model, but that's just ahistorical. The scientists who developed this were highly apolitical in their development of this model. So now let's look at what the greenhouse gases are. And there are a number of them, and many of them are some of your favorite gases in the world. Water vapor, we all love water vapor. You may think you don't like humidity, but on those February days when we get a reasonable amount of humidity and you can take off your coat, we feel warmer even at 50 because of that humidity. And when you're going around with just your bathing suit on and it's in the low 70s, high 60s, and you're not cold, that's because you have a lot of humidity around you. Methane, you know about methane. It's natural gas that comes out of your stove burners if you live in the district. Carbon dioxide, we've all heard about carbon dioxide. It's the product of cellular respiration and also of combustion. CFCs, which are also known as freons, which were refrigerants, and we'll learn more about them when we learn about the ozone hole later in the year. Ozone itself is a greenhouse gas, and so since that's a pollutant made by internal combustion engines, particularly on warm days, that can function as a greenhouse gas, but fortunately, it's at such a low concentration that it doesn't really have a big effect on warming. And then nitrous oxide, that is laughing gas. It makes you laugh uproariously, and it's what your dentist uses to make you feel numb but not unconscious when they're drilling into your teeth. Of these two, the two most important are, you could have guessed it, water and carbon dioxide. The Nathan Hale operator right here, that is telling you that, I'm going to give you a little question, a little extra credit question here. Can you see the positive feedback loop that is set up by temperature and more evaporation if water vapor itself is a potent greenhouse gas? Okay, I'll leave you to figure that out. Talk about it in class with you. Now, foreshadowing. And we're not going to talk about it this much this unit, but the next unit, the climate change global warming unit, the concentration of greenhouse gases has increased drastically due to anthropogenic sources over the last century and a half. And by this time, you should know the word anthropogenic, genic meaning generating, anthropo meaning human, human-generated sources over the last century and a half. Some people try to debate that, but the data is indisputable. And I'll show you the data in the next unit, and you will see it is indisputable. Indisputable.
So that's it for this talk. Tomorrow, we will go on to talking about seasonality and how seasonality affects global temperature. But until then, don't forget, study hard.